want to thank all of you who attended the Block 22 groundbreaking this morning. There's a lot of familiar faces. I think it's more about the exciting substance what we're talking about than that you're following me around. I just happen to be at each of them. But we did have an incredible start to the day with the Block 22 groundbreaking. I hope everybody who attended feels the same way. It's more evidence of the reason why I love Pittsburgh so much more than Topeka. We actually get things accomplished and get things done, and we do it for the good of all, and we don't let divisive things that don't matter so much get in the way. So this morning was a great example of that. So now that we've had that great thing this morning, now we get to talk about the reality in Topeka, which is different than the reality in Pittsburgh, Kansas. And so I appreciate all of your interest in what's going on. I'm going to go ahead and introduce Riley Scott to come up as well. You remember Riley? He's my teammate up in Topeka, and pleased that he's up here with us, and he's going to help me make sure I say all the right things.
That's right. So thank you. Happy to be here. Thanks for having me.
So the first thing that I think of interest that we want to discuss is what's going to happen in the 13th Senate District. Most of you know that as of last week, Jake Turner was appointed by the governor as Secretary of the Treasurer.
Treasurer.
State Treasurer.
State Treasurer.
Secretary. I think I have a fever, so he's here. Secretary of the State Treasurer, he was appointed, which means his seat is now open.
I believe actually sworn in today. Jake is sworn in today as State Treasurer.
This, of course, was precipitated because of Ron Estes winning the special election to be the congressman. And now Jake Turner, as of today, is sworn in as the State Treasurer. That means that as of right now, we actually don't have a senator from the 13th District. So just so you all have an idea of how this process works, on Sunday, about 90 electors will get together. And those 90 electors will determine who the senator will be for the remainder of the 2017 session, who will go in at the veto session, but also who will serve during the 2018 session. 2018, there will be a special election to fill out the remaining 2 years. One thing is for sure, well, actually two things. Number one, it's possible there's going to be more candidates than there are electors, from what I'm hearing. There's a lot of folks popping up. Number two is it's a foregone conclusion it will be a Republican. So, because the Republican electors are who choose for this session and next session.
Correct.
So, that is Sunday. He took office the 25th. Sunday, which is the 30th, is the day that they will vote.
And then May 1st, that new senator will be sworn in when we come back in for the veto session. So, day one, that person will be there and ready to vote to represent your interests.
Now, I know that in President Scott's going to speak at the end to put some of this all in some broader context. I think this is one thing he and I have both, and Riley for that matter, have been having conversations with folks who are interested in running for this seat. We're not approaching them to encourage them to run. They're coming to us saying, hey, we'd like to run. We want to know what you guys think about education and these kinds of things. I can think of no less than 4 or 5 phone calls, texts, or emails that I've received from individuals. My sense is that means there must be even more than that that are mulling this about and thinking about it. This clearly is an incredible opportunity for someone who may have thought of filling a seat like this to get in and only have to worry about 90 votes as opposed to, you know, however many are in the total district. The district is all of Crawford, all of Cherokee, and a portion of Bourbon County. That's where the electors will come from. And we can, when we get to the end, this can be something I'm sure some people have some questions, we can discuss it. So that's where we're at on the 13th District. I think the next issue of importance and what we've been tracking the entire session and of highest importance has to do with budget and revenue, and the two are completely intertwined.
Right, and your new senator will come in with a lot of work to be done and won't have much leeway or time to get ready before they start voting on issues of extreme importance, a tax plan, a two-year budget plan, and then funding for K through 12, a funding formula for K through 12. So,
and a two-year budget.
Two-year budget. We're going to get to work right away, at least potentially. Sometimes it takes a little while for things to come together. But rest assured, your new senator will be there for those discussions.
So here's where we are as of today. The FY17 rescission bill passed both chambers, has been signed by the governor, includes no cuts to higher education. So that is a victory. We had been thinking that it was possible that there were times of discussion wherein we had as much as 5% or 7% that we thought might get cut.
After last November's consensus revenue group met, we were short $350 million for the fiscal year. So we essentially had 7 months to make up $350 million. And so we were staring down the barrel of at least 3 to 5% cut and ended up not receiving any cuts. So that's a short-term victory, but a significant one.
So April 20th, last week, the Consensus Revenue Estimating Group came together, and for the first time in 3 years, they actually upgraded their projections as to the amount of revenue that we will have. This projection is the projection upon which the legislature will base its budget decisions, mm-hmm. and as well as revenue decisions, is on this projection. This projects estimates up that projection by $156 million, or 1%. Again, that's the first time that we've seen an upward revision in 3 years. During that 3 years, you'll recall we had month after month after month of missing projections, and then they would downgrade the projections, and then that we would still miss them. Since November has been the first time, and we've had consecutive months, wherein we've actually been beating those projections or been right at.
Right, and this was part of the joke, I think, last time we were here. Eventually, if you set estimates low enough, you're going to exceed them. And so, or maybe it's just the law of averages working in our favor finally. Whatever it is, it's good news, because those consistent month shortfalls put a lot of pressure on the existing budget in terms of finding revenues and finding a way to balance it. So hitting estimates or even being above estimates is good news for higher education.
From a strategic planning and goal setting standpoint, I would never encourage lowering the bar until you actually meet it. But I'm glad that they're actually meeting it.
FICA has different metrics.
They do have different metrics. So here's where we are right now. So that's what we know for sure. We know the consensus revenue estimate is out. We know that FY17, we're not going to be cut. Those are two things that we know for sure. Here are the unknowns. The Senate and the legislature has to pass an FY18, FY19 budget. We're in these two-year budget cycles.
And as of right now, with the new consensus revenue numbers, we went from about $1 billion short over the next two fiscal years to about $900 million. So still significant chunk of change, but $900 million is better than $1 billion. So search for any sort of positive.
Yes. Right. Congratulations to us.
Yeah, that's right.
So finding a solution to the budget and revenue challenges that we face will be the number one and almost exclusive priority. If you throw in, if you just throw in the fact that they're going to have to come up with a school finance formula as well, they don't have much to do in 2 weeks, right? I mean, they've got 14 days to figure this out. But what we're looking at now is the situation of when you take the fact that we already had $1 billion gap, and then the court decision comes out and says that we are currently not constitutionally funding our schools, they have to come up with a new formula, which estimates on how much additional that's going to be range from $50 million all the way up to $1 billion a year in additional revenue. The Senate has passed a budget. That budget does not include any cuts to higher ed. It essentially holds us steady at the FY17 levels, which doesn't mean there weren't actually cuts embedded in there, because there are, obviously, because we're lower than we were 3 years ago, but it holds us harmless from 17.
And the Senate budget is about $80 million more than the governor's proposal for FY18 and 19. So it spends about $80 million more than the governor's proposal does.
Now, the House and the Senate, if you'll recall back in February when there was a flurry of activity, they indicated an appetite and a willingness to increase income taxes. And in fact, both chambers voted on a $600 million increase to taxes, which would have filled just over half of what we're now looking at as far as a gap goes. That gap, I presume you're including the school finance numbers in that.
That gap is a two-year gap, and this $600 million number is actually a one-year number. So that tax proposal would raise $600 million additionally annually. Right.
So the House and the Senate both passed this tax increase that would have increased and raised estimated $600 million in additional revenue. The governor vetoed this. the House and the Senate tried to override the veto. The House actually got the votes necessary to override, and the Senate fell three votes shy of overriding the governor's veto. This shows to you that there is substantial appetite to try to fix at least this initial $500 million per year hole. The challenge is that now when you add in the court's decision, and you're thinking that this could at least mean another $500 million, they probably don't have the appetite to raise taxes, income taxes, by $1 billion. So that means we probably are going to have sufficient appetite once they take out, again, a reminder of a little bit of the history on this. The biggest issue probably with the reason why in causing them not to override the veto in the Senate was the retroactive piece. The tax increase would have been retroactive on everybody back to January 1, and there was at least three who said that was just a bridge too far. So what we'll probably see is an income tax proposal which will raise more like $500 million or $500 million, takes out the retroactivity, which is about $100 million, and that will take care of more or less the gap that we currently believe we have.
Right. It takes away about $100 million in annual revenue. The retroactivity piece, again, this is all subject to change, would still apply to LLCs, small business owners, so they would still have to pay taxes retroactively. And that it's obviously very well known about small business owners not having to pay any income tax. It's all but over. Everyone's essentially decided that that's changing, and they'll be most likely pay taxes at the same rate that wage earners pay. What that rate is, to be determined. Right now it's 4.6. There's been some discussion of it going up to 5 or 5.25, et cetera. It just sort of varies, and it depends on how they can get the votes for that. But to Sean's point, yes, the retroactivity piece will be out of it, which just means it's a little bit less in terms of its overall revenue that it brings in. But it still should be sufficient to cover the budget gap with a little bit of excess revenue to have in the bank.
So that then takes us to that next really important elephant in the room, and that's the K-12 funding. They are going to have to come up with a new funding formula. That funding formula, we're thinking, is going to be, at a minimum, the expectation of an increase is $150 million. It's probably going to be closer to half a billion.
Could be.
We think it's going to be closer to half a billion. And one of the things to consider on this is, as I said, I don't see them raising income taxes by $1 billion. So how else are you going to fix it? There's a few options. One is you pass a funding formula which increases by $100-150 million. The court looks at it and says, that's still not enough, go back and do more. That's a possibility. Another possibility is they actually ratchet that number up to $300+ million, and they fund that through property taxes. So there currently is a statewide mill levy that funds K-12 education. And so one approach could be that they fill the $500,000 gap that exists right now prior to the K-12 funding decision with income taxes, and then they fill the remainder with property taxes, and they say, you can thank your Supreme Court for this.
Mm-hmm. The governor's proposal initially at the start of the session was to use an increase in taxes on tobacco and liquor, and those aren't very popular. Tobacco, I think, has a chance to still be in play, but it's less likely. We just, as a state, I believe 2 years ago, raised the tobacco tax by 50 cents. So there's, I think, less of a chance that tobacco passes, and the liquor increase is kind of dead on arrival. So Sean's right. It appears the legislature has determined we're going to raise income taxes to fill the budget gap. Anything beyond that, i.e. K-12 additional increases in spending, will be raised through some other measure, and it's property taxes. There was an idea that I just heard about yesterday, which was a $3 surcharge, essentially, on any utility bill that you pay. So gas, electric, etc., per month, that would be dedicated revenue for the increase in K-12. Not a very good idea, but there aren't very many good ideas out there. So it's kind of which is the least bad idea that can pass. Raising taxes is obviously not a fun conversation. And if you're talking about raising, putting a tax on a utility bill, that's regressive. but sales tax increases are regressive as well. So it's just, they're in a hard spot, and they're going to have to make some tough decisions that I think they realize many people back home in their districts won't be pleased about.
So now moving on to some selected bills of interest. As we go through this list, I think you'll probably be convinced of what I'm convinced of, is that one good thing that occurs in years when they're debating two-year budget is that they don't do a whole lot.
Right.
It's sort of a do-no-harm opportunity for us not to get nailed with one thing after another of our interesting ideas. So one thing I know that's of great interest to everyone here, we have consistently advocated that we do not believe that more guns on campus make our campus safer. We also, though, have come to the realization over the past couple of years that the exemption is going away, and so we have to prepare for that new reality. We have moved toward that. We've studied that. We've had our processes to go through that. And then there's been these ideas of what if we could resurrect the permanent exemption for higher ed with regard to concealed carry. Now, I don't want to be the bearer of negative news, but what I will say is that I think the chances of us having a permanent exemption are almost zero.
I would agree.
I think that we are, maybe, you know, there are other states right now that are debating this issue. And so, like, for instance, Missouri, Missouri has a governor that can take apart and put together a gun in like 45 seconds or whatever it is.
Blindfolded.
That was part of his campaign, actually. My guess is that he's probably going to be doing a similar thing there. But what you're seeing in those states where it is not yet there, you're having more negotiation about, well, can we exempt sports arenas? Can we exempt dorms? I think, for better or for worse, the train's kind of pulled out of the station already for us on this.
Yeah, there was a, as you all are familiar with, there was a law passed 4 years ago that said July 1, 2017, you can carry a gun on college campuses as well as other places. What's been interesting is just recently the legislature sort of determined what they did, or at least what the legislature did 4 years ago, and they realized that July 1, 2017, you're now going to be allowed to carry a gun at Osawatomie Mental Health Facility or State Hospital or Parsons or K&I in Topeka or Larned. So the legislature, I believe, thinks that's not an appropriate action, and they will be working to find an exemption for those state hospitals as well as possibly KU Hospital and maybe potentially other public hospitals across the state. So I believe Sean is correct that universities don't stand much of a chance in terms of gaining an exemption, just be aware that that debate is coming. There will be a debate on this, likely the Senate floor, but it could be the House floor as well, about exemptions and whether or not guns should be allowed in public facilities like hospitals and state hospitals. And certainly, I believe a university amendment will likely come from somebody. The issue is the governor has just said he's not willing to sign a permanent exemption for universities. He has not said that about hospitals at this point.
The governor has more or less indicated that if higher education is included in this exemption, he'll veto the bill. This puts us in an awkward position with our friends at KU Hospital, say, for instance, because the folks at KU Hospital don't necessarily want to be seen as aligned with us on these things, this thing, because they want their exemption. But at the same time, we all agree that this is probably not the place to have a lot of guns. So it's an interesting argument that's been going on. I, as Riley has indicated too, I think that if a higher education exemption ends up on whatever the broad bill is, the governor vetoes it. And I think, now, that all being said, our faculty senate has taken the same position that every faculty senate in the Board of Regents system has taken, which is in opposition to and in support of a permanent exemption.
I believe they've sent letters to all legislators to that effect.
We've worked with Janice Jewett with that to help her to have the list. So she sent that out to every member of the House and the Senate. They all know the position of the faculty here. You know, the Board of Regents has also not taken a position formally. And so that's something for you all to keep in mind as we're advocating. The board itself has not taken a position on this. And so, but our students have. Our students, the student group of all of the students actually joined together and lobbied on this issue. Aaron, USS, the support staff? Or I mean, university support, okay, has support staff, do you know? Have the other Senates, Michael? So the other two senates here, I'm not taking a position at all. But the faculty senate has taken a position, and the student senate has taken a position. That has been communicated. I am not at all discouraging anybody from communicating that. Just do it on your own computer and all those other caveats that we have. But I think the fact that there is going to be a debate about it is even more reason for it. If you have interest in this, that you say something to our local folks especially. Here's another issue that we were... Do you have something?
No, go ahead.
One of the issues we have been dealing with is this challenge that we were going to be facing with regard to folks who are retired under CAPERS. They come here and they work for us. So let's say they were an administrator or a teacher at USD. They retire, they come and they're an instructor for us, or they're a faculty member for us, even if they're taking tickets at the games. This would have, without this exemption, it would have basically limited their CAPERS payouts, which would have in turn meant it would be very difficult for us to get people who have a lot of years of contribution left, particularly in education, from coming and working here. And especially when you take in consideration across the border, they don't have a similar restriction. It would have mean that anybody from this region would probably, if they're going to go teach at a university, they would go somewhere other than Pittsburgh State. So this was important for us.
And this issue has passed passed the House. It's waiting for Senate passage. It's expected to happen relatively quickly and that the governor will sign it. So not officially done, but on the right track.
The next is Senate Bill 174. This is the Wichita State University WATC affiliation. This started out as a merger. It was watered down substantially to be an affiliation. This is basically a connection between Wichita State and the technical school. As you all might recall, we tried to be trailblazers in this regard with Fort Scott Community College. We went down the road a little ways on that. It was determined from Fort Scott Community College's, or from their community standpoint, that this was not desired. Why this is important is that this could be sort of another hurdle knocked down toward encouragement of universities and technical colleges or community colleges to find ways to work together, to find greater efficiencies, to find better synergies and create pipelines for students that are more effective and efficient for educating Kansans.
That's correct. And this bill has passed, has been signed into law, will go into effect July 1. I think there's still some lag time in terms of different accreditations that have to happen before it becomes official. But this is an interesting debate. As Sean mentioned, Pitt State's been a leader in this this area for the last couple of years and found a lot of resistance from community colleges and others. However, this bill itself, I don't believe there was a single dissenting vote in the House or the Senate. So it's interesting, sometimes issues just take a little while to mature and they just kind of flip. And this one, it feels like now, has sort of flipped and people recognize, you know what, maybe there are some synergies there that we can find in higher education. Whereas even last year, this actual bill, as Sean said, it was a merger, not an affiliation, was essentially killed in committee because there was so much opposition to it. So I think issues just mature at a different pace, and I think this issue has now matured, and we have a legislature who's willing to consider affiliations like this and others.
If you think about the level of pressure that we're under from a financial standpoint, from a fiscal standpoint, you would assume many times that that pressure is doubled or even more when you're thinking of smaller institutions like community colleges and technical colleges. But also this sense of, and we've done a great job of working together within in the paradigm that we're in. It just makes sense for Kansans, for these institutions to work together more. And if we really want to increase the number of post-secondary credentials, we need to work together. So, is that it?
That's it.
That's
questions.
It. So, President Scott's going to come up. He's going to put some things into context. I think he's going to talk about some other aspects. But then when he's finished, we'll be open for some questions. Thank you.
All right. Thank you both very much. Well, you know, really, you think about it, it's almost like a civic lesson. Seriously. I mean, and those of you, Aaron and Michael and others who've served in leadership roles at the Regents level, know that this doesn't necessarily happen on every campus. So I appreciate the work you do to clarify the issues and really put in front of people what those issues are and kind of the steps that we've been through and give some context to. So that's extremely helpful. I thought it might be helpful if we had a show of hands of who's not running for the 13th district. So our phone is ringing off the hook now. And the good thing, and Sean pointed this out, the good thing is I think people believe the path to that role is certainly got to pass through Pittsburg State. So had a nice phone conversation with one of the candidates, and I'm not giving any names right now, but one of the candidates yesterday had a nice conversation late in the day by phone, met another candidate at the event we had earlier today, and then tomorrow morning we have somebody coming into campus to talk to us about that role. And you know, you heard me, Sean, you heard me launch into the conversation today when you introduced me as the president, here's a potential candidate for the 13th district seat. I didn't throw up on him. But it was kind of this, here's what we need. Predictability, stability, let's pay our bills, let's get this house in order. That's what we need to do. And Riley laid out the timeline. Whoever gets elected, the next day they go to Topeka and they get sworn in. The next day they get sworn at. I think that's the way it's going to work. Right. Because I asked the guy yesterday afternoon, I said, are you ready to take some hard votes? There are going to be some very hard votes. And they might give that person a pass, they might not, because they really won't be in the fold and they won't be in the caucus. And I don't know how that will all work. So it's really going to be an interesting time for us. And certainly we wish Jake well. But it's going to be an interesting time as we move into with this new representation. But I think it's important that you all know that we're participating in those conversations. We won't go vote. We're not going to be in that. Is that going to be in a living room somewhere or a Pizza Hut? Or
yeah, that's
where
right.
Is that going to be? Do you know?
I think it's at a community center.
Oh, here. It's a community center in Frontenac, maybe, mm-hmm. or someplace. So it'll be a pretty interesting thing, and it'll be government, or at least the legislative process in action and at a very grassroots level, and you'll see what that looks like. And you probably don't know who your precinct chairman is, but that person's going to play a critical role in making these decisions, so it's kind of interesting. I want to mention several things. One is you saw the term with the WSU-WOTC affiliation. The reason that vote was unanimous was because they removed the word merger. At one time in that legislation, they were really talking about a merger, and that's exactly what we were talking about with Fort Scott. We were going to bring our two institutions together really, we're going to merge them. They're going to keep their name, and they're going to keep their athletic identity, and they're going to keep their accreditation. But we were going to merge, and that was the effort. And that was the effort that started at Wichita State and WOTC. And there was an uproar from the community colleges. They did not want to see it go that far. They pushed back, dropped back to the affiliation term, which seems a little, I don't know what that means. It's not slow dancing, maybe it's fast dancing. I don't know what the metaphor is, but you get the idea. So nonetheless, it's an important step. There's just no doubt about that. There is an important step. I think you're exactly right. That particular topic is ripened, and we probably have some opportunities to move in that direction. So then FY17, that was very, very good news that FY17's budget was not cut. From the president of the university's perspective, from the work that we do in Topeka, that was very, very good news. As a Kansan, as someone who grew up in the state, it was not good news, because the state borrowed more money to make that happen. So we ought to all keep that in mind. Sure, we're going to breathe a sigh of relief, but I don't think it was a particularly good set of decisions that got us there, because they're borrowing more money, okay? So that's just a fact. That won't help the state's credit rating, I'm guessing. Having predictability in the revenue collections will help the state credit rating, I would guess. Any kind of greater stability is going to be important to us going forward. But in FY17, nonetheless, we dodged a bullet. We thought we might see $1.5 million cut. And so we did act internally in the fall. We took some money back. We had budgeted money that we said to the four divisions, you can't spend those dollars, and here's how many dollars you need to give back to us. We recaptured about $1.6 million, $1.7 million, something in that category. Well, you might think, well, gosh, now that we didn't get a cut, let's just release those dollars. But what happened in the meantime? Our enrollment dropped. So it's a good thing that we did that, because we positioned ourselves to move through the year more successfully. If we hadn't done that, we would have had some challenges. So that's 17. So you think about FY 18 and 19 then. One thing is, the more savings we have, the more dollars we have, the more reserves we have, the better off we are. So that's pretty clear. That's just the same in your budget. As you enter each month or enter each year, the better shape your savings is, the more likely you are to be able to have flexibility and deal with some of the unexpected things that you face. So as we enter 18 and 19, what are the things we're watching? What matters to us? Well, you guys talked about one of them, and that's the state allocation. And right now, the budget that's been passed in the Senate has us flat. that would be a very, very good thing, right? I mean, it's sad, but that's where we are right now. If we could be flat, we would take that. So what else impacts our financial picture then going forward as we think about 18 and 19? Not only the state allocation, but enrollment, right? Enrollment affects that. And another piece that affects it is tuition, because this is the time of year we're having conversations with the regents, and Doug's doing that at the Finance and Audit Committee meetings, about what do we think we need to do in the tuition space in terms of tuition and fees, what kind of increases do we need just to deal with fixed costs that are increasing. So you see, we've got state allocation to be concerned about, we've got to set our tuition levels, and we've got to deal with enrollment. Where is enrollment? So on the tuition side, you would suspect that we've raised tuition quite a bit over the years, and I think the Kansas Board of Regents is probably not going to tolerate much of a tuition increase, I'm guessing. And everybody in this room, nobody in this room likes tuition increases, because everybody here has the sense of we want to provide access. So we're caught in a bind, really, of we want access, but we also want an exceptional or excellent experience for our students. So how do you bring those into balance? And we've done that over the years. I think we've done that pretty well. We've tried to mitigate tuition increases by reallocating and cutting our costs where we could and looking for savings and try to minimize those increases going forward. And I think we've done a pretty good job of doing that. But where we find ourselves now is with a tuition level that, while it's very, very competitive for our neighbors and other MIAA institutions, very competitive. It's in good shape. But we also see challenges in enrollment. So this last fall, we were down 180-some students, I believe, as we went fall to fall. And that was at the undergraduate level. That's a big, big deal. And so students are doing what right now? They've just finished their pre-enrollment for the fall. Now, what you would hope to see is that rebound. And we just fill all that back in. Enrollment would move back to where it was. Modest tuition adjustment. And state has a flat budget, and we move on. And life's pretty good, really. Now, we're still financially challenged, there's no doubt, but life in this era, at this moment, is not too bad, given that scenario. The problem is the students haven't pre-enrolled at the numbers we expected them to. They've not, it's just a fact. So we don't know if that's a pattern of they just haven't taken the time to get it done, they've got other things to do, or they've got jobs to go to, or they're just not paying attention or what it is, but we need everybody's help to move those numbers, because that's a huge factor in all this. And you know, years ago, and some of you have been here as long as I have, years ago we didn't own our tuition. Do you remember that? We actually collected tuition, we sent it to Topeka, but we got dollars back that were different dollars. I don't know if they washed them or converted them into different currency. Remember that, Michelle? And so in some ways it almost didn't matter. You know, you'd try to get to a certain level, you'd budget for a certain level, but if you didn't get to that level, you still got money back, and if you got more enrollment than you thought, you get a mid-year adjustment. Remember that? Then they quit doing the mid-year adjustments, and then they came up with this concept called tuition ownership. And tuition ownership, if you're like me and most people in these kinds of roles, like, that's what I want. I want the accountability here. Let's generate the revenue here, let's invest the revenue here, and let's make this work, and we're responsible for it. That's the good side of it. The bad side of it is if the revenue doesn't get collected, then you've got to make some decisions about how to deal with that. So right now, we've got some challenges. I just want to be very clear about that. So you might leave the meeting and say, gosh, you know, those two guys are really sharp, and they did a great job. But when the president started speaking, I got a little nervous. But it's the reality, and they painted a picture that may occur in terms of a flat, or we may get somewhat of a reduction there if the appetite for a property tax increase or some other increase doesn't show up for the K-12 finance formula. So, yeah, how do you sleep at night? Doug, are you sleeping at night okay?
Not as well as I used to.
Yeah, really. Man. So we've faced these things before, and you know, sometimes the leadership group will talk about the fact that we talk openly about these challenges, and every single time, what do? We navigate our way through them. And you know, post the 2008-2009 recession, we took a 14% cut, I think 13% 1 year and a 1% after that, a 14% cut in our allocation. But we had a little bit of a tuition increase in there, and then we also had the bump of, in a recession, students returned to school. So you had the enrollment moved up, the revenue collections moved up, and we filled that gap. And right now we're in kind of a different setting in that employment levels are extremely high. We have students who can take a few classes and go to work, students who graduate the baccalaureate degree who 3 or 4 years ago might say, I'm gonna hang around and get a master's degree, and now they're off working. And that's where we want them. That's that transformational experience and the outcome we're looking for. But that doesn't help us on the enrollment side. So it's a big deal, and every single person in this room can help on that in terms of encouraging students to get enrolled, encouraging your neighbors, your grandkids, your nieces, your nephews, and everybody else. I know you believe in this place. We need to all be helping to sell this place and promote enrollment. So we've got some challenges ahead of us. We're watching Topeka, we're watching our enrollment numbers, and we're planning our tuition proposal. But there's a lot of moving parts at this point in time. So with that, encouraging, huh? But if you want to smile, go to YouTube later today and watch Not Cats. Because I know most of you just watch cats at night. Isn't that on YouTube? There are a lot of cats playing. But watch Sean Naccarato hammering a nail. Because this morning at our ribbon cutting, groundbreaking, nail, whatever. I go, what'd you call it? Chris, what do you call it? You're the man with words. You're lost too. We were nailing nails into a board at block 22. And Sean, all he had to do was nail this thing. It was this long. And his first whack, I mean, the thing just turned sideways. So I hope that's not an omen for the whole project. I'm just hoping it's not. He did. He was so proud of himself. He knew what the claw was for. He got it straightened back up, and then he grasped the hammer right at the neck, and then he does this, right? He is one of those kids. He's one of those people who went through school and never took industrial arts, right? Did you take industrial arts?
I'm embarrassed to say that I did, and I didn't learn enough, apparently.
Didn't you make a little bread basket or something? Come on up here.
I took ag shop, actually. Well,
so seriously, I want to drive numbers for the YouTube channel. You've got to go see it. We really had a lot of fun. It was a great event. And they gave me the biggest hammer. So I did have an advantage. I had a huge hammer. And they had pre-bored the hole that I nailed.
Just yours,
mine.
I think.
I think that was the deal. It was like a prank. So what questions, what concerns? I know there's a lot there and there's worries there, but what's on your mind? What do you want to talk about? Anybody?
I just realized we didn't really go through the schedule for the veto session.
Yeah,
so
yeah,
I
you want to tell
probably
where this is going.
That. We come back in on May 1. That is officially day 76 of the session. Statutorily, it's a 90-day session. We are scheduled to get out May 14th, which is Sunday, Mother's Day. That is optimistic at best. 2 years ago, I think you'll probably all recall, we set a record. 2015, I think we were in for 114 days. So if that's the case, I've got 40 days ahead of me in Topeka with legislators. It's not a pretty concept. But the Senate, and I believe the House as well, in an effort to sort of break people's wills and get them to vote for a tax plan and a budget, are talking about when they come back in on May 1st, working 7 days straight. And 7 days will turn into 14 and 21, and until they get to the point where they either override the governor on the tax veto, or they pass a plan that he's willing to sign. And at this point, it's kind of interesting. He indicated he would be willing to sign a flat tax proposal, which would remove the exemption for the LLCs. I believe it got 3 votes in the Senate. So they either need to find 18 votes in the Senate to pass that, or they need to find 3 votes to override him and get from 24 to 27. So it's math. It's not all that difficult, but it's politics too, which complicates things. So in any event, come back in on May 1st. We are there until we're done. Again, 90 days is May 14th, but expect it to go beyond that. Hopefully by Memorial Day, you know, graduations are happening. People want to get to high school graduations, college, university graduations. that starts to break people's will, and we're not there in June like we were 2 years ago.
You know, that reminds me, there's another topic that's out there related to this timeline, and that's the governor. And I know we're web streaming this, or recording this, so you've got to be careful what you say.
Right.
But what does that look like in terms of, we know the governor may have an opportunity to gain an appointment.
That's a good point. At this point, I would expect it to happen. I think I'd be more surprised if it didn't happen than if it did, if the governor would receive some sort of ambassadorship somewhere. It's not an easy process. He would be appointed, or nominated, I should say, and then he'd need to get confirmed by the U.S. Senate. And that, you'd have to go through a committee hearing, and then they have to schedule a floor vote. It certainly doesn't happen before the end of this session.
Right, right.
But we're probably, if it does happen, we're probably looking at July, August, maybe September, before he's out the door. And then Jeff Collier, who's the lieutenant governor, will become governor. He then gets to appoint who his lieutenant governor will be. So there's a lot of moving parts. And then, you know, kind of looking ahead to 2018, you all obviously will have a special election for a Senate seat. All the House seats will be open. And then all the statewides will be open. So does, at that time, if he is governor, does Governor Jeff Collier run for election as governor? Does he not? It's a wide open race at that point. So a lot of movement in Kansas politics over the next couple of years. And then even looking 2 years further out, Pat Roberts' seat will be up again. Whether he runs for re-election or not is you know, certainly up to him, and no one knows. But possibility for a lot of moving parts.
And then Lynn Jenkins has announced she's not going to run again. Of course, she's our congresswoman, and there's some movement towards that. Some interest in that position.
For sure. Yeah, and I now Treasurer LaTurner, I guess officially today, has indicated he plans to seek election for treasurer in 18.
Right.
We had thought he might run for the second district congressional seat. Looks like that's probably not going to happen now. But I also would say I think there's going to be a crowd in that field too.
It will be. Paul Davis, who's the Democratic nominee for governor in 2014, he lives in Lawrence. He's announced he's looking at running for Congress.
Which means he's running.
So he'd stand a decent chance to win that seat. That's a seat that's trended more blue or more Democratic over the last couple cycles.
All right. Questions? Yeah. Randy? For the web, I'm going to restate that. Would you give us a little description of Lieutenant Governor Collier?
Sure.
I'll let you do that, Riley.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you.
He's been down to Pitt State, by the way, to a couple of football games.
Yeah, a couple of football games.
Yeah, so nice time visit with him.
I don't believe pleading the fifth is an opportunity here. I would, unlike other states where you have the Lieutenant Governor run on their own and not a part of a ticket, Kansas acts much like the federal level where he is a part of the Brownback ticket. He's the longest serving Lieutenant Governor in Kansas history. Typically, they serve one term. That happened with Governor Sebelius. Her Lieutenant Governor left and Parkinson took the spot in the second term. So Collier would be in line with Brownback in terms of philosophically where he's at. He's a plastic surgeon, a doctor by trade. He has been most focused in healthcare and the state's managed care operations. So there would certainly be a learning curve, but I think he'd be helped by the fact that one, he was at one point a state senator from Johnson County, and again, he's the longest-serving lieutenant governor in history, and probably had more of an active role as a lieutenant governor than most lieutenant governors have. It's a seat or a position you can kind of make it what you want to, and Brownback very clearly said, Collier, you take over healthcare, and they moved from a fee-for-service operation for Medicaid to a managed care operation, which was a big change, and he's been sort of the father of that.
Of course, who gets appointed to fill his slot, if that all happens, will be big, just like state treasurer position. When those open up and somebody gets to make an appointment, you talk about a leg up on the next race.
It does. And like with Jake's appointment, does not require Senate confirmation. So it's anybody that person wants. They typically have to be a voting age and live in Kansas.
Do they have to be able to drive a nail? Because we don't want Sean to leave.
Okay.
We want Sean to stay here.
Joke that Sean could probably talk the nail. Board, not nail it.
Get down.
What'd you say?
You're not going to live that down.
We can show you how.
I know. I'm hoping.
If you're getting ready.
Can you show me how?
How about a nail gun? We'll have a nail gun next time. What else? Anything else? Anybody? We'll hang around if people have questions. I said this is going to be over in 48 minutes. Didn't I, Jamie? What time is it?
Nailed it.
Pretty darn.
Oh, that was good.
Very good. All right, you guys are great to come out this afternoon. Yep, go ahead and enjoy that day. I'm going to go to the patio at some point.